Here's another image of the succession of images that can happen during an eclipse. Here's the moon, and in this image here, the moon's obviously sort of moving in this way. Okay, moving in this way. And so you can see that it continues to take a larger and larger and larger bite out of the sun until finally you get to that really interesting coronal region right here. And these are kind of fun. These two points in time are kind of fun as well, because you can see there's still a little bit of the sun going through, but the corona has now become apparent. It's darkened the sun enough to see the corona around on the outside like that. And so both of these phases here are called the diamond ring phase. Not really, phase is sort of a, doesn't really mean anything, but just a phase of the sequence right here. So there's a diamond ring here and here for obvious reasons. Looks like a diamond ring. Then of course the moon just continues on its journey throughout its way. It doesn't know anything happened at all, and then ends up leaving the sun alone, and then we're sort of back to where we started again. Okay, and so I just want to make a travel recommendation to you, is that I really want to encourage you, please try to go see an eclipse at some point in your life. So it turns out that these nice paths to totality that I showed you several slides ago don't always happen in such a convenient way. Like, it wasn't even that easy to get to Wyoming for me. I just happened to be in that part of the country. A lot of people from California drove up to Oregon, but of course traffic was just a nightmare. It really was. Even when I left the eclipse in Glendale, Wyoming, it took something like 5 hours to get back to the Denver area. It's normally a 1 hour drive, something like that. So it's not always convenient, but what you can do is sometimes when the path of totality happens out over the ocean, you can take a cruise where the captain will promise to take you out there. So look, as long as you're going on vacation, why don't you take a cruise that you can have all the fun on the cruise, but you can also see an eclipse, and sometimes they helicopter in an astronomer to explain to you what's happening, of course. So it's all very fun. But what can kill it, and they don't give you your money back for this thing, are, of course, clouds. If you happen to get a cloud a day, that's too bad. And you hear all kinds of stories of people going on ships just to see eclipses, and it's a very cloudy day, but just as the eclipse happens, the sky parts and you get to see it, things like that. But anyway, keep that in mind. As long as you're going on a vacation, make it an astronomy vacation. And please send me an email if you do. I'd really like to hear about it or see some pics. So I'll probably just be here teaching astronomy 101. Okay, so it turns out that eclipses do happen on other planets, but remember, it won't be total, because that ratio of the planet to the moon to the sun distances, size and distances, just aren't correct. But here's an eclipse on Jupiter. This is that first moon, Io or Io, which I told you about in our introduction to the course here. And you can see right there, there's the shadow. So if you happen to be standing like right there, it would get dark suddenly, but you'd see the big sun around you, because it's not going to block the whole sun, but it would get a little darker for you there. Of course, if you're standing on Jupiter, you can't stand on Jupiter because it's made out of gas and the gravity's so strong it'd crush your back. But anyway, hey, anything to see an eclipse, right? And so what'll happen is sometimes when it's not quite total, this has to do with the fact that sometimes the moon is a little bit closer to Earth when it's not total. You see something quite nice, but you get the annular eclipse here. So this is not the corona, because we didn't get as much blockage as we needed. So this is still just actual the bright sun. And these, you really shouldn't even look at these. This is gonna be very bright still. These portions here are still very bright. But it says annular here because annular is a word that means the outer part of a circle. So you see the annular eclipse right here. Those are fine and those are common. I've seen one of those once. And sometimes the moon will be a bit off center like that. And there is a lot of history about these eclipses happening that were captured in artwork. I mentioned artwork, at least, I think, in the introduction to the course. There's the Battle of Halley's here, where, let's see, it was a five-year war between some words I don't know how to pronounce, but it ended abruptly during a total solar eclipse. So the war was going on for 5 years, but then this total eclipse happened, everyone got dark and freaked out, and it stopped. It was perceived as an omen indicating that gods wanted the fighting to stop. So, hey, there you go. Some things in history right there. Battle of Halley's. There's also a big story about Einstein in eclipses, which I'll tell you about in the very next video. But Einstein got his big start, or his name suddenly become a household name, during a solar eclipse, because one of his theories was able to be verified. Now, we'll tell you about that in the next video. And also, artwork captures eclipses from time to time, so this would be sort of a darkened day, and for whatever reason the artist, you know, captured what was in the sky, in this case the moon blocking the sun. Tough time for astronomers, though, because the Emperor Zongkang beheaded two astronomers who failed to predict the eclipse 4,000 years ago. So, like, I'm sitting here, you're an astronomy professor. I guess I'd be a little bit careful here about some of the things I say in class. Beheaded for missing an eclipse, huh? Oh, my God. Okay, so in the next video, I'll wrap up and tell you how Albert Einstein got his household name.